Obviously. Lander en Boekersbaum. Third theorem, which says that the following conditions are equivalent. The first condition for every mass, so we are given a ring which is local or standard graded. For every module M finitely generated, we have the projective dimension of the module is finite. So the projective dimension is the length of the unique minimal free resolution of the module over the local ring. So see, when we are in the local setting, we can talk about minimal free resolutions, so free resolution which are minimal in the sense that the maps, they have entries in the maximal ideal. Okay, so it turns out that the minimal free resolution, they are really minimal in terms of length. They are the shortest possible free resolutions that the module might have. Okay, so the first condition say every module which is finitely generated has a finite free resolution. And the second condition is the residue field has a finite free resolution. And the third condition is that the ring is regular. So this is the original formulation of the Auslander-Buchsbaum Serre theorem. Homological characterization of regularity, which was something which was missing in the beginning. I mean, when the Zariski started to, started the foundation of algebraic geometry with commutative algebra, there was a notion of regularity for rings which was imported from geometry, which was, the right notion if you come from algebraic geometry, but not so flexible in the commutative algebra world. So they came up with this definition of regularity for a local ring, and they proved this characterization, which allowed one to prove, for instance, that if you have a regular local ring, then any localization will stay regular. Something which, with the original definition, imported from algebraic geometry, was not at all easy to prove. And so this was, the important contribution of the homological methods to the introduction to the homological methods to the commutative algebra. And here we may add an extra condition, which is of course it's easily seen, equivalent to the other. The Kozul complex. Say the Kozul complex on the generator of the maximal ideal is a free resolution. Okay. Okay. This is, maybe we can put it in brackets because usually we don't state it like this. Okay, so somehow this says that the ring over which the Hilbert-Sydenham theorem works, so the Hilbert-Sydenham theorem says over the polynomial ring every module has a finite free resolution. So you can ask yourself, apart from the polynomial ring, what are the rings for which the Hilbert-Sydenham theorem works? And in the local setting, these are the regular rings. Okay, and as I said, among the many modules that you have, the most trivial one is the residue field. But from the homological point of view, it's the most important, because if K is a finite free resolution, then every module has a finite free resolution. And this comes from the fact that you can compute the tor either resolving one argument or they are resolving the other argument, with the key point relating the resolution of K to the resolution of any other model. Okay. Okay, maybe let's try to. So I state everything in the local setting, but I always claim there is a graded counterpart of what I'm saying. So if you like more graded setting, if you like more projective geometry, I mean there is every statement has its graded counterpart. We can take and we take an and we can talk about the unique minimal free resolution. The minimal free resolution is unique up to an isomorphism of complexes. So you may really think it's a unique object up to choices of bases. And then we say the Betti number of n as an R module, the ith Betti number of n as an R module is by definition is the rank of Fi. And the important point is that the rank of this module, so you can compute it by taking the dimension as k vector space of the tor I of n comma k. Because if you take the minimal free resolution and you tensor with k, all the differential will vanish, because minimal means the differential in the resolution, they are entries in the maximal ideal. If you tensor the resolution of n with k, all the differential will become trivial. And when you compute homology, you will get just as many copy of k as the rank of phi is.
Okay. So you mean the complex is the minimal free resolution of n?
Huh? This is the minimal free resolution of n. Okay, I didn't say it. I mean, this complex, let's say this is a minimal free resolution of n. N is any module. And by definition, the Betti numbers of n as a module over R is just the rank of Fi, the number of copy of R that we put in the homological position I. So then, I mean, you can take this resolution, tensor with k, the differential will vanish. And so you see that the rank of Fi is really the k vector space dimension of this module. But this vector space, k vector space dimension, this module, you can also compute it by resolving k and tensoring with n. Okay, so provided we have some information about the resolution of k, we can turn this computation of the Betti numbers into a computation of the some other complex, the complex that you get by resolving k first and then tensoring with n. So this tells you why, for instance, if you have two, you have one, because if the resolution of k is finite, if I go over the projective dimension of k, these numbers will be zero. So every module has a resolution which is the length of the resolution of k, because of this formula. We show you how to prove 2 implies 1. Okay. And of course, it also allows us to give another interpretation of the Betti numbers in terms of Kozul homology over a regular local ring. If R is local regular, so we want to interpret this tor in some other way. So if R is regular, we know the resolution of K. It's a Kozul complex on the set of generators of the maximal ideal of R. So then we take the Kodur complex with tensor with n, and we take homology. But this is a Kodur homology. So if the ring is regular, then we have another interpretation of the Betti numbers. The Betti numbers, they are given by the dimension of the Kodur homology. So the Kodur homology with coefficient in with respect to the generator of the maximum idea of R, coefficient in N. So this is somehow give tells you another way why the Kodur homology is important. When we compute Kodur homology of a certain module over the over a regular ring, we are really trying to say something about the syzygy of this module. Okay, so somehow, when you want to compute a free resolution, usually suppose you are given a module, you know the generators, and maybe you map the free modules to subjectively onto your module. You have to compute the kernel and so on. Okay, somehow. This other perspective say there is a complex. The complex is given. Okay, when you want to compute Betti numbers, the complex is given. It's a Kodur complex. You have only to compute homology, and of course you can take advantage of the fact that you know that these modules they have an extra algebra structure. For instance, we have said before the Kodur homology they form in this case a module. So it is not just a bunch of modules. If you put all of them together, they form then a big object, which is the total Kodur homology, which has a module structure. And sometimes you can take advantage of this property.
And can we see any relation between that homology module and our free resolution degree, I component? The relation between Fi and Hi.
I mean, what we know that they have the same rank, right? So the only thing. And there are algorithms that allows you, suppose I'm giving you the Kodur homology, and you are free to choose a basis of the Kodur homology. Can I build the resolution by this information? There are algorithms like that. So there are procedures to follow to build the maps, because I mean, the complex, the free resolution is made by the modules, but also by the maps, right? Sometimes we really need the maps. Sometimes you have to compute the so-called fitting invariants. So they are really data which comes not only from the modules, but they come from the map. You have to take determinants of the matrices representing the maps. So if you just know the rank, you know. Don't have enough information. So sometimes you really need to have put your hand in the maps. If you know just the Kodur homology, you don't know the maps. You just know the rank. But there are strategies and there are algorithms which allows you to build the maps from that piece of information. Okay, there are papers about which were written about 15 years ago concerning this problem.
Hey. So in this case, all the higher homology is generated by the first one, or this is some more condition.
We will come to this point in a few maybe moments. Okay. I mean, sometimes you are maybe most of the time, we really want to study syzygies of rings, not of modules. So this situation most of the time is we have a ring which is, I like to call the regular ring S, because it's come from most of the time I work in the graded setting where the regular ring is a polynomial ring which is a symmetric algebra of vector space. So maybe I switch from R to S. This is the regular ring, and I have another ring which most of the time in the interesting situation is non-regular, it's just a quotient. And what we usually try to do is resolve resolve R as an S module. So this is a free, so S free resolution of R. So this is this. So I mean, I just replace N. I just replace the ring R with the ring S. So I want to study the syzygy of R as an S module. And this is just the dimension of the Couture homology of the maximal ideal of S with coefficients in R. Okay, let me here assume, maybe just for convenience, that the ideal of definition is contained in the square of the maximal ideal of S. It's an assumption you can always make. It's like when you have an ideal which contains a linear form, you can model out the linear form and forget about it. You can always reach this situation. Okay. So now here we have the Couture homology of the maximal ideal of S against the coefficients R. But I mean, when I tensor the Couture complex of on the generator of S, of maximal ideal of S with R, what I get is just the Couture complex. So the point here is that this Couture complex gets identified with the Couture complex of the maximal ideal of R with the generators in R. It's the same thing. I mean, when I tensor free S module with R, I replace S with R, and everything which is in I becomes zero. So, and the maps, they are what they are. I mean, there is no problem. Okay, so this gives us a new interpretation of the Couture homology of the maximal ideal of any local ring. So if I'm giving any local ring, need not to be irregular, I can take the Couture complex on the set of the maximal, of the generator of the maximal ideal, I get a complex, and what there is homology. Usually, if the ring is non-regular, there is homology. Okay? Because if the ring R is non-regular, now there is some homology. And what is this homology? What does it tell? It tells the number of generators that I need in the free resolution of R as a module over some regular local ring which dominates it, so to say. Okay. So I mean, if I take a local ring and I construct the Couture complex on the maximal, on the generator of the maximal ideal with coefficient in the ring, this homology is trivial if the ring is regular. Give me the resolution of K. If the ring is non-regular, is not regular, so there is homology. What does it mean? The homology means the syzygies of R as a module over S, where S is a regular ring presenting the given module. Maybe an example here is, let's take a very, very simple and maybe stupid example. I take the ring is kx modulo x squared, and S is a polynomial ring, is just in one variable. Okay, so if I want to see the resolution of R as an S module, the resolution of R as an S module is this. It's just multiplication by x squared. So the resolution of this complex. Now let's try to compute instead the Couture complex of the maximal ideal of R, so the maximal ideal of R with coefficient in R. So this is this complex, right? It's, there is just one, this is just one element. Now there is this complex as homology. So the homology 0 is the residue field. And this is always so. What is the homology in homological position 1? So in the ring R, I have to consider the kernel of the multiplication by X, modulo the image of the next map. There is no image. So it's just the kernel of the multiplication of X. What is the kernel of the multiplication by X in this ring? Is the ideal generated by X, because X squared is 0. So this is the ideal generated by the residue class of X. And it's a vector space of dimension 1 in this quotient ring. So this is, again, isomorphic to K. So the rank here is 1 and 1. This tells me that in the resolution of R as an S modulus, the three modules, they have rank 1 and 1, which is something as we see over here. So they are different complexes. We pass from one to the other by this fact that we can interpret Tor in two ways. So the relationship between the two comes from that double interpretation. Okay. So once again, if I have a regular ring, the Couture complex is the resolution. If we have a non-regular ring, it has homology, but this homology tells me something about the syzygy of the non-regular ring as a module over the regular ring. Okay. So once again, one reason why the Couture homology is important. Okay. Of course, the importance of the Couture complex comes from the fact that it gives the resolution of K in the regular setting. So you can ask yourself, okay, let's now talk about some ring which is non-regular. So we know that the resolution of K will be infinite by the Auslander-Buchsbaum set theorem. What can we say about this resolution? It's infinite, but can we somehow describe it in some way? And now, so this is, we have to talk a little bit about the so-called Tate construction. So the Tate construction is a procedure which allows you to start from a complex which is a DG algebra like the Couture complex, but not exact. It allows you to build a complex which is still a DG algebra, and it is maybe not yet exact, but it is better than the one you started with. So it somehow it improves the situation. And it improves the situation by applying just one principle: add new variables to kill homology. This is the motto behind the construction. So add variables to kill homology. I mean, if you read the original paper of Tate, it says this construction is somehow the most naive construction that you can imagine. And but it's very important and effective. So we get back to the first part of my lecture. So we start with A, which is a DG algebra over R. And suppose there is some homology, some non-trivial homology in some position. So I take some non-zero homology in homological position I. Now I want to build a new a new DG algebra, which is somehow close, as close as possible to I, such that this homology class vanishes in the new homology ring. So what I do is the following. It very much depends on the fact that I is odd or even. If I is even, say I is 2j plus 2j, I do an extension of A by adding a variable. So I add a variable whose name is E. So if I add a variable whose name is E, it means this variable is an exterior variable. So this variable is must satisfy E squared equals 0. And I put it in the odd degree T2j plus 1. So if I write like this, means with an exterior algebra, it will anti-commute with everything which has odd degree, and it will commute with all the other elements. So as a module, this is just A plus A, direct sum A. And the multiplicative structure comes from this rule and from the rule that I just told you. Okay. And now I have to extend the differential, so the DG algebra is. And in the differential, I just say phi of E goes to Z. This is the only thing that I have to tell you, because the element of A, I know how to apply the differential on the element of A. It's the original data. So I just have to tell you how to define the differential on the new variable, and then extend in a way such that you get DG algebra on the larger ring. Okay, so how do we know that phi squared is 0? Because phi squared was 0 on A, and what about on E? Phi of E is Z, but Z was an homology class, so it came from a cycle. So Z is a cycle indeed. So if I apply phi once again, I get 0. So this is somehow its concise way of constructing a larger DG algebra containing the original one, such that homology class disappears now. Of course, it disappears. Maybe I built some new homology class somewhere else, so I pay a price, but at least I killed that homology class. And if I instead, if I is odd, say it is 2j minus I, I now consider a polynomial extension. So I add polynomial variables. So E stands for exterior variable, S polynomial variable. And again, so I add it in degree 2j, and I define phi S equal to Z. So now this time, this is as a name module, is just the polynomial ring in one extra variable over A. Okay. And when you are in characteristic 0, this is fine. When you are in characteristic, prime characteristic, one has to be a little bit worried about strange things. So this is really the polynomial ring in characteristic 0. If you are in finite characteristic, you have to be careful. Okay, but this is just a warning in case you want to apply this construction in finite characteristic.
But if S is just polynomial variable, then its arbitrary power never vanishes, so probably we might have infinite degree DG algebra.
Yeah.
So is it okay still?
It's okay. Of course, he is worrying about you want to find a free resolution, and you add a polynomial value, you are lost. Okay. This is what Tate said. This is the most naive way that you have to keep the DG algebra, because of course we want to keep the DG algebra structure. Of course, what everybody knows, if you want to build a resolution, you start from the beginning. You take a set of generators, map, free elements, compute kernel keep on going. So you build it from the beginning, with and you don't care about building DG algebras. It's just a free resolution. And if you do it in minimal at each step, you are sure that if the modus has a finite free resolution, you will find it. You cannot take somehow wrong direction. If you just do the naive thing, you will build the minimal free resolution. But here we have the point that we want to keep the DG algebra because we have seen the Couture complex is so nice, and we want to keep that property.
Mm. So okay. Usually, such an naive construction might have some sort of universal property. So, does it also happen?
There is some little potential. Freedom here. When we talk about class in here, of course, class is defined up to boundaries. So there is maybe here you lose a little bit of universality because in the construction you have to make some choice here. Okay. So this is a way in which you have something that you don't like and you just do the only thing that you can do in order to preserve the DG structure and annihilate the element that you want to annihilate. Now this gives us a way of course we sometimes one write like this or sometimes one write like this. So I add this variable with the condition that phi of E is Z. And if I say E, I mean this is an exterior algebra. If I say S, it's a polynomial variable. Okay, so this gave us a way of writing down the Couture complex. Okay. So with this notation, I can write quickly the Couture complex. So the Couture complex on this list of elements with coefficient in R can be written like I add to the ring R n exterior variable all in degree 1, so I put down here the degrees, and I define the differential such that phi of Vi is xi. So this is a concise way of defining again the Couture complex from this perspective. So I tell you what is the ring. It's an exterior extension of the ring R. And I tell you the differential. I just had to tell you where the generators go. Okay. So now let's come to the Tate construction. And then maybe it's time to conclude the lecture. Right? The Tate construction says the following. The problem is this. We start with the Couture complex. We want to build a resolution of some ideal, keeping the DG algebra structure. So we start, we have an ideal in a ring. This ideal has certain generators, x1, xn, and the first thing that we do is we take the Couture complex. So it's T1 because it's level 1 of the construction. Or if you want, as I wrote before, we add EI with the condition that phi EI is XI. Okay, now what do we know about T1, we know that the homology in the position 0 is what we want. We really want to resolve R mod I. But it might have homology already in position 1. And indeed, we know by the discussion before, if it has homology, it must have homology in degree 1 because of the rigidity. Okay, now we take the homology of the Couture complex in degree 1 and take set of generators, say they are z1 to z, some number, say h1. And we define t2 just by adding as many polynomial variables in degree 2 to kill these guys. So this level two in the construction of state is I take T1 and I add polynomial variable S1 as H1 in degree 2, so I put below the degrees, and I just use them to kill this homology classes. So at this stage, what do we have? So this algebra in degree 0 and in degree 1 was the map from degree 1 to degree 0 has been, it is not touched by this deformation. So what I get is that H 0 of T2 is still R mod I. And when I compute H1, the map from degree 1 to degree 0 is what it was, right? So, and I know that up to the old boundaries, these were the generators. But now they became boundaries in the meantime in the new complex. So this tell me that the H1 of T2 is now zero. So there is no homology in degree 2 because I have had enough new guys to kill all of them. But of course, this T2 now, it might have homology in degree 2. It might have homology in degree 2 because of the Couture complex or because of the new guys that I introduced. Okay, now I do the same thing. So I take H2 of T2. We don't know what it is, but it's... I'm talking about finite generation. You can also... maybe H1 is not finite. Who knows? Okay. You can build the construction in a very general setting. Then in concrete situation, all these modules, they are finitely generated. You can pick finitely generated, finite system of generators. Okay, so let's don't worry about this. So here we have new elements. So Z, let's call them again Z1, Z so and so, H2. They are not the same as before. They are the new one. And now I add, I want to kill homology in the even degree. I have to add elements in the odd degree, and they must be exterior elements. So E1, E, H2, and the condition now is if the differential is obtained by like this. And now you know what is going on. The H0 of T3 is what it was, R mod I. The H1 of T3 and the H2 of T3, now it is zero, but there might be homology in degree 3. But I keep on going. Okay, so I define the same way I define TS by the same token, and then I finally say T is just the union of all this. So I define T. So let's say the union of all this TS, okay. But in practice, you add to the ring R bunch of elements in each degree, which are built in terms of the preview data. Okay. So now this T, what we can say is a DG algebra resolution of R mod I. Just because at the end there is no homology, because we keep on kill. Of course, it's a very huge construction, okay. But it works. Okay. So you can build a resolution of R mod I, which is a DG algebra. And of course, it's usually very far from being minimal because of what you observed already. Suppose our ring is a polynomial, ring, and I start with a ring with an idea which is not a complete intersection. So already, I have homology in the homological position 1, and I need to add polynomial variables. And as soon as I add the polynomial variable, the polynomial variable has infinite many powers, right? And so it will give me an infinite resolution for an idea that Hilbert says it has finite free resolution. I am going to build an infinite resolution. It's a price to pay if you want DG algebra structure in such a universal way. I mean, okay. So usually not minimal. And here comes a very big surprise. Maybe one of the most important theorem in this area. It's the theorem of Gullickson. Gullickson is a mathematician from Norway. His first name is Thor, which is a name that if you do homological algebra, it's...
Thor.
Thor Gullickson. So it is not... The theorem says the following. Start with the local ring. And say the maximal ideal as generator x1 xn. Apply. Take. Construction. And 2 is a Kozul complex. The Kozul complex. And you get the minimal free resolution of the residue field. So it's an important word. It's a minimal free resolution of K. So what we have said is true in many cases, but it is not at all true if you want to resolve the residue field in a local ring. This construction will give you the minimal free resolution. So the feeling that you have from the beginning is that what he said. I mean, you are adding too much. You want just to kill an homology class there, and you add things which will last forever. Okay, this is something that you must do if you want to resolve the residue field. Over R. We are resolving over R. Okay. And maybe it's a good time for stopping. Okay.
Question, comment?